There's many VM sizes to choose from in the cloud. Which one is right for you? Well, it sort of depends on your workload. And just recently, there were some new sizes added, and we should really take a look at them, and let's have some fun. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. So I had a few people reach out to me in regards to the new sizes that we're going to take a look at today and asking about certain features. And one in particular was quite interesting because it's something I haven't thought about in a long time. Over in the Azure docs, if we scroll down, we got the Windows Virtual Machines here, and let's click on that. And in the filter over here, we're going to type the word size, and we'll click on this first option here for VM sizes. There's many different families of virtual machines, from general purpose down to high performance compute, as you can see in the docs, and each one of those families has within it many different sizes to pick from. And one of the key things to controlling your cost in the cloud is picking the right size virtual machine for your workload so that you can get done what you need to do, but don't over-provision the system so that you have wasted resources. So on June 15th, it was announced that the D&E V4 virtual machine series were introduced to the cloud, and V4 is the latest generation as of this video. And the D series are the general purpose virtual machines, and these new V4 ones are running on the Intel Xeon Platinum 8272CL processors that go up to 3.4 gigahertz, turboing on all cores. And that means you can get more CPU performance. The E series are the memory optimized virtual machines. So if you're using some high memory intensive applications and also need to have premium or ultra disk performance, then you can go with the E series V4 machines. Over in the Azure portal, our VMs have also gotten a facelift. You can see things look quite a bit different. We've actually got little subcategories now for our virtual machines. And on the properties window, you've got your basic VM information, the name, the operating system, which generation it is. You also see the version of the Azure agent that is on it now, whether or not you're located in a proximity placement group, and also your networking information, as well as your VM size and disk layout. On the monitoring tab, we can see all of the standard Azure monitoring stuff for your disks, network, and CPU. Under capabilities, we have some quick links just to kind of centralize everything in one place rather than going down the blade like you have in the past. And there's even a tutorial section now so that you can get a little more understanding of how to manage your virtual machines and some links out to some free training on Microsoft Learn. Now, the feature that caught my eye again this week was nested virtualization. Nested virtualization is when we can have a virtual machine, and inside that virtual machine, we can run other virtual machines. Kind of like the same concept around containers, but it's done slightly differently. Back in the Azure docs, if we go back to our Windows virtual machines, under the how-to guides, under managed VMs, and we scroll down, we can enable nested virtual machines in Azure. And this is a feature that is accessible to you if you are using the right VM sizes. And you can see this first link talks about the virtual machine sizes compatible with nested virtualization, and the brand new DV4 series are also compatible. And this doc basically walks us through today's process. We're going to build ourselves a virtual machine that's compatible with this feature, enable Hyper-V inside the virtual machine, and then we're going to have to set up a NAT virtual switch inside the machine so that our VMs can get out and make use of all the other resources that we have in the cloud. And you'll see a lot of these similar concepts when we introduce our videos on Kubernetes and containers. But I want to scroll back up a little bit to this section on enable Hyper-V feature in an Azure VM, because there are two links here that we need to pay attention to. We'll open this first one on the NV blog, which is the nested virtualization blog. So this graphic gives us an idea of what's going to be going on today. So at the very bottom, level zero, that would be Azure. That's the physical servers running in the Azure data centers. And then you build your virtual machines on top of those. On the VM sizes that support nested virtualization, you can install the Hyper-V role on those systems, and then you can provision your own guests within there, going down to level number 2. But it doesn't have to stop there. You can reprovision Hyper-V again and then go down to level 3 and so on. And once you get into that nested virtualization layer, the system doesn't know any different, so it functions just like it would on any other physical device. So not only is this a very cool feature, but it's also something we're going to have a little fun with today. So you've already seen my virtual machine in Azure, and this is provisioned with one of the new DV4 VMs. I have 4 CPUs and 16 gigs of RAM, and this VM is already up and running. And in here I have enabled Hyper-V, and then I have another machine here called Level 2, and I'm going to show you how to get this all up and running to where your VMs can get out to the internet even from these nested levels. And that also means you'll be able to join your domains that are either on-prem or running in Azure and have access to all of the same features and functionality that you would in any normal environment. So back in the Azure portal, let's start at the beginning. We'll deploy a new virtual machine, and I'll just search for Windows Server 2019 and then set my publisher here for Microsoft. Then we'll click on Windows Server and select the particular SKU that we are interested in. I just used the 2019 data center, and we'll hit create on that. And I'll build this in my resource group that's called Nested. We'll call this VM Hyper-2 in the East US. And if we scroll down for our VM size, we have the DV4 VM size here selected, but there are other sizes. And now Azure shows you the ones you have recently used, as well as those recommended by the image publisher. And you've got this one right up here that I'll call your attention to, the D4ASV4. And this is one of the new AMD EPYC processor VMs that are in the cloud. So there's another great option for you. But I'll stick with the size I built the other system on just to keep them all identical. And I've got my credentials all listed here, and we'll hit next. And I'll be using a premium SSD for this system because I need to run the operating system disk as well as the virtual machine disks, but I could just as easily add multiple data disks and then link them together with Windows storage spaces or storage spaces direct. But we'll keep this simple for this example, and we'll go next. And I'll use my existing virtual network in Azure and click next. And I've added all my standard tags for this build, and we'll hit next. And everything looks good, so let's create. Now, normally I go to a black screen here while the creation process happens because it normally takes a couple minutes. However, these new V4 VMs actually deploy quite quickly. Now, your mileage, of course, may vary, but I'm having this timer here so you can see how long the build process takes. And so I'll speed it up so we can get to the end here and you can see exactly how long it took to provision a new V4 system. And there you go, we are now built. Back in the Azure docs, here we have all of the commands that are necessary to get all of this up and running. And so I'll just copy each one of these code blocks from this entire page into my PowerShell. So the very first command here that we're going to run is to install the Hyper-V feature, and then we're gonna reboot our system. So we'll run that real quick. So if everything has worked correctly so far, you should have the Hyper-V manager on your system, which I'll open. And when you open Hyper-V for the first time, it's going to be unconfigured, and you can go through and set where you want your virtual machines and hard drives to be stored. And we're also going to need to set up a virtual switch, and that's what some of the code here that we got out of the Azure docs is going to do next. And this is where I made some small tweaks to the code that's right out of the Azure docs, and I'll explain why. So I want this to run as automated as completely possible. So I'm going to create my new switch. When I do, that switch is going to get an index. So if I run the PowerShell command for getNetAdapter, you'll see that every network card on every machine everywhere gets an index. Okay, and that's a unique identifier that lets the system know which NIC it's talking to. So when we create this new switch, we're going to get an index as well. And in the docs, they tell you to run this command, then run getNetAdapter, check what the index number is, and then use that in the command that's on line 17. But I didn't want to do that. I wanted this to be totally automated. So I had it go and create the switch. then wait for 2 seconds, and then run this variable and capture the index. And then I pass the index to command 17 and do this all in an automated way. So I can run this whole thing now, which will be done in just a moment. And there we go. We've now captured our index and passed it correctly, as well as set up this last command, which is the new net nat command, which does internal network address translation so that we can get our nested VMs out to the rest of the network. So now that all of that is configured, if we go back to Hyper-V and look at our virtual switch manager, we have a new network switch created, and this is an internal only switch. And if we run the getNet adapter command again, we can see that now we've got 2 network cards, our network card that we got from Azure, as well as the one that we have just generated as part of our virtual switch. So now we can provision a new virtual machine, and I'll call it Nested VM, and I'll build it in the C Hyper-V folder, and I will make this a Generation 2 VM, and I'll allow it to use dynamic memory, and then we'll connect it to our internal NAT, and I'll make my hard drive 64 gigs, and then we'll install our image from an ISO that I copied down locally for server 2019, and we'll click finish, and then we'll go to connect to our VM, then we'll push start to get it running, and we'll press a key to boot off of our ISO, and we can start our installation of Windows. So I'll just fast forward to the end here, and our VM is up and running. However, if we try to go out to the internet, we see things are not working. And if we try to ping out to our domain, again, not working. So what's going on? If we do an IP config, we see that we do not have a valid IP address. Now you can solve this in 2 ways. You can set yourself manually an IP address on this virtual machine, or you can set up your own DHCP scope. Now, this is a thing that we don't normally do in Azure because Azure is our DHCP, but in this nested virtualization world, we don't have that. So we do have the option of standing it up and making a scope that's going to be internal only. So back on our Hyper-2 host machine, we're going to add a DHCP role, and we'll do that by going up to manage and then going to add a role and feature, and we'll click next on the wizard. And then we'll just check the box for DHCP server and click add feature, and then hit next, and then install. And now that that's done, we'll click the link here to complete the DHCP configuration. And on the DHCP administration console, we'll right click on IPv4 and create ourselves a new scope. And I'll call this a nested scope. And then we have to set an IP range for our nested VMs. And I'll use a private IP range for this and click next. And then I want to add some exclusions here, and I'll exclude from .1 through .99, and that's just in case I want to add more hosts later, and I'll click next. And the default lease duration of 8 days is fine with me, and I'll click next to configure our scope options, and this is going to be the IP address of our virtual network switch, and I'll click add for that and hit next. And here is the key to making this work, the DNS server settings. You want to leave these with whatever your Azure virtual machine is giving you. So back in Azure, if we look at our virtual machine and click over here on our virtual network subnet, you can see at the top here listed is my DNS servers, and those match what we just saw inside our scope. And these need to match so that your VMs internally can talk to the virtual switch on the host and then go out to the DNS servers that Hyper-2 is using so that you can get out to all the public DNS resources. And we'll click next on the rest of the wizard and activate our scope. And in order for us to get our new address information, we need to run a couple commands. So I'll run ipconfig space forward slash flush DNS, just in case there was anything there. I'll also run ipconfig forward slash release, and then ipconfig forward slash renew. And now you see I've gotten my DNS information and a gateway, and in the background here, Bing has now started to work, and we are up and running. So now I can ping my domain controller, and now we get a valid response. So everything is now up and running. So now that we have all of this, what can we do with it? I've created another VM in the background. This is to deploy Windows 10, and I will connect to this machine and just start it up. And would you look at that? I can do PXE Boot in Azure, something that is not natively supported, but because I'm on my own internal private network, I can now do a PXE Boot. So doing your image customization and all that could be shifted up into Azure, leveraging some kind of nested Hyper-V scenario. And notice I'm using here the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, and I've already got a task sequence configured. And that is going through and setting up my system over a PXE Boot. And we'll come back and check on that in a moment. Back in our nested VM, I've already run the PowerShell exactly as we did on our level above it. And Hyper-V is already installed, and I've got my nested NAT virtual switch configured already. And I've pre-staged a virtual machine here as well, which I can go ahead and connect to and hit start. And there you go, three levels deep on nested virtualization. And if we go back to our other build from PXE, that has completed as well. So you could use this as creating your own environments inside of Azure, your own isolated lab environments, testing scenarios, or you can implement things like clustering. The one thing that you do need to keep in mind is that everything is ultimately running on one virtual machine in Azure. So the further down the rabbit hole you go, the fewer system resources are going to be at your disposal. And that means that your top level virtual machine might need to be a larger virtual machine, depending on how much nested virtualization you are planning on doing. And once again, here's that graphic. We have the Azure physical host layer 0 at the bottom. And then we've got our Hyper 2 VM that we deployed at level 1, nested VM at level 2, and then a Windows 10 VM at level 3. And these principles will all carry over when we start talking about our container series and the Azure Kubernetes service. So I hope that you've enjoyed looking at this fun video about nested virtualization and the new VM SKUs that are in Azure. And of course, nested virtualization is just one of the very cool things you can do in the cloud. So if you had a good time today or learned something new, go ahead and click that thumbs up and let me know that you appreciated this video. And if you have any questions about this or any other things going on around Azure, give me those in the comments field down below and I'll be sure to respond to them. And especially let me know if you have an idea for a new video. We always love to make things that the community is interested in. Today's video was inspired by conversations I had with folks this week. And if you haven't subscribed yet to the Azure Academy, it's not getting any cheaper. So join us here at our community because everything here is totally free. And we just want to help everyone learn more about Azure. And to help you keep on learning, over here on the right, we've got our latest video on the top and one that we've picked out at the bottom, especially for you. So I hope you enjoyed today's video and come back and see us soon. Happy learning.